let's start from scratch here.
As Northern Uganda continues to nurse the impact of the LRA rule, which caused a lot of spiritual, moral, psychological, and infrastructural damages, spiritual transformation has not been given any attention because it is only the work of God through His special grace and mercy. The establishment of Thou art the Christ, therefore, was inspired by the Holy Spirit and purely built on love, sacrifice, and hard work. We believe that absolute holiness, complete obedience to the word of God, and aggressive prayer can help the revival of the region. Thou art the Christ is therefore happy for being divinely connected to the Shewbread ministry and the Three Angels Fellowship. We would like to thank the Shewbread for offering Northern Uganda the opportunity to study the word of God through the Shewbread Bible College. Thank you also for funding the roofing of our church and saving us from the challenges and embarrassment of praying under a tree. To the members of Thou Art the Christ, thank you so much for your prayers, present, and hard work towards this construction. However, we request you to continue supporting us so that we finalize the remaining phase of the construction in order to strengthen our capacity to spread the good news, especially the Three Angels' message to Ugandans, Africans, and the entire world.
Actually, we are so grateful for what you have done to our church and all the things that you have offered for us, started from the other time, from December program, and this Bible college, plus this contribution towards this construction of this church.
Ateke foj ma de total da iya yom pegen ma Shewbread gitega ti yune bodwa ang ken ma chalo Bible wajo ne ching ma kwanyo mi teke gum ange ne loba be mi gum ma de total bos yu awat pegin ma getika ti yune ne chake ma mukate iduma para rio ne o kere wai chawa ne.
I want to appreciate you all for each and every effort that you have made to support the at the Christ. Others has endeavored to give financial support, others who are praying for us. And I also wanted to thank Pastor Geoffrey Okart for all his effort, and we hope that if possible, when this COVID pandemic ends, we should meet and we shake hands, since it is an African culture, to greet, to laugh, and to share together.
I want to thank you for laying out the foundation of the Bible truth. We have learned a lot, and I believe we still have a long way to go. So any kind of support, we still welcome.
All right, I just want to pause it there. There's another one that I'll play. And I just want to kind of give you just a little bit of background. So in the beginning of the video, it was showing just different clips of, you know, the surrounding area. It was describing how they have been under basically civil war for the last three or four decades. And there's a lot of different just damage psychologically as well as infrastructurally because of that. And so they had started Thou Art the Christ ministry there as a means of bringing, you know, the truth of Jesus to the people who were steeped in paganism, you know, witchcraft, all kinds of different things. But they themselves have been transformed. And this next clip that you'll see, it's the remark of the chairman of the building committee. And she describes how there in their region, you know, a person might wake up in the morning and say, well, I have a call of God, I'm going to start a church, but they don't have any kind of Bible training. And so they are really appreciative of the things that we've been able to go over with them and share with them over this, the course of this year that we've been having the Bible college. And there are numerous churches. We have talked about this before, how there are numerous churches and pastors involved. But one of the things that we have not done is we realize that we're starting with people who are very green. very, very fresh when it comes to present truth, Bible truth in general. And so we haven't dealt with and talked about certain things. You know, these are mostly Pentecostal type of worship services that they have. And so we never really talked about the music. We haven't talked about speaking in tongues, dancing, drums, all of these different things. You may have seen some of the clips, how they have the, their worship is very, it's not like we worship, right? So we haven't said anything, but what's really interesting is over the course of the college, every single week I'm in contact with these people and we talk, these brothers and sisters. And last week specifically, they contacted me and they said, you know, Pastor Sankey, we've been, you know, having church services, you know, they keep Sabbath now, they're not worshiping on Sunday. They're still using Sunday as a day where they can do, prayer and just different studies and religious work in the area, because everybody in the area keeps Sunday if they do go to church at all. So they use that day for missionary efforts. But they were saying, you know, we're starting to realize that the messages that we're learning and the way that we worship, it doesn't seem to gel. It doesn't seem to mix. Is there anything in the Bible that speaks against drums and dancing and these different things in the church? And so we always able to share with them these things. And then, you know, shortly after that, it was, you know, does the Bible say anything about speaking in tongues? That style of worship. And so I was able to share with them with that as well. So, you know, even though we're not dealing with those topics or have not dealt with those topics specifically yet in the Bible college, the Holy Spirit is really convicting the hearts of these people, and their minds and eyes are being enlightened as the entrance of the word is being given. The word is being given them, entering into their heart, and everything about their experience, their church experience, is changing. And they are really praising God for it. There hasn't been anyone kicking against the pricks, and so that's just been a tremendous blessing. I'm going to play this next clip here. This is a word from, the building chairperson of the building committee, Sorry, I did something there. Let me fix that back.
My name is Irene Omona. I am the chairperson of the building committee of the church you see at the background. I want to extend my appreciation to Shewbread Ministry for the support that you've rendered to us in the construction of the church and in doing other activities. In the same way, I appreciate everybody who extended support to us, and that's why we've been able to put up the structure that you see at the background. Thou Art the Christ currently is the only church in this community that has been well established with at least a structure, apart from the traditional churches like the Protestant Church, the Catholic Church, and the Muslim. Now that the roof is done, our next step is to ensure that there's a wall on the church. And as you know, this church is established in the rural setting, and the church members really don't have much to offer, but we are trying our best to gather together the available resources that we can to ensure that the church has a wall, and then also we want to ensure that the church is well furnished with at least some seats. So we are still extending our request to you, if you can still continue with your support to us so that we are able to put the wall for the church and also to furnish it with chairs. In Africa, people just wake up in the morning and they say, I have a call from God, without the knowledge of the word. You've given us the Bible school, and this is helping to shape our leaders. For this is not only going to stop here, but it's going to spread the word throughout this community and Uganda and Africa as a whole. I want to appreciate you so much for everything that you've done, but I also want to take this opportunity to invite you to come here on the ground and see what the Lord is doing on this land. May God bless you so much, and please stay safe until we meet again.
All right. So that is a video. Two videos that they shared with us, and you know, they really wanted to make sure that we play that for the church, so that the church members can see the progress and the things that are taking place there, as well as just to give you an idea of how appreciative they are. So I fulfilled my duty. I promised Pastor Okot that I would do so this week. And so I wanted to show that video. It's just a blessing to my heart to just be a part of this work and working with the brethren there. And they are looking forward. So they're looking forward to a face-to-face, which we had planned back in 2019 and 2020. And of course, COVID messed those plans up. However, they're still looking forward to a face-to-face. And now they want to have a full mission, missionary work service is done there. So the medical missionary work, Bible teaching, so on and so forth, they're looking forward to that. So we're kind of planning out by God's grace. So if anyone is willing and able to be a missionary volunteer, and you're interested in going to Africa and doing work with the brethren there in Kitgum, Uganda, in the Gulu province area there of Uganda, you let me know. I'll keep that before you as we make the plans continuously. All right. So at this time, we're going to go ahead and open with a word of prayer for our study time. And then after that, we will jump right into the word. So let's go ahead and pray. Our loving Father in heaven, we thank you for being so good to us and for taking care of our needs. Lord, we are also thankful that you have provided for us in ways in which we are not even, ways in which we don't even know. And Father, all the things that we have, all the things that we behold on a daily basis in our homes, in our churches, many times, Lord, we take for granted, but we are thankful, Lord, especially when we consider the millions, billions around the world who are not as taken care of, I would say, in a economic way as we are. And we're just thankful that you have provided for us. And I pray, Lord, that you would help us to realize that all that we have are given to us as talents, that we might trade upon them and use them in the Lord's service. And so for our brethren around the world who are starving for the word of God, as well as for just the basic necessities of life, we pray that you would help us to open up our hearts and open up our pockets and our hands to be the givers of great benevolence to them. And so, Lord, I pray that you would guide us and be with us. And even now, Father, as we open your word, we pray that we would be inspired by the thoughts of Scripture as it relates to the table of showbread. So bless us now, in Jesus' name we pray, amen. All right, so let me get into this here. So we have been talking about the sanctuary, of course, and we have now finished with the outer court. We've dealt with the altar of burnt sacrifice. We've had a few nights on the laver. And there's much more that can be shared with each and every aspect that we have already covered, but we're just kind of piece it and use it as kind of devotional thoughts, right? So we've dealt with the courtyard experience, which is the justification from sin. And now we're entering into the holy place of the tabernacle where we find sanctification. And so the sanctification experience that we're going to see as we enter into the sanctuary, the holy place of the sanctuary, This allows us to grow in grace. This is where we find ourselves growing in Christ unto a perfect man, unto the measure and stature of the fullness of Christ. This is where we are rounding and developing our spiritual aptitude. And so we're going to start looking at each of the different figures of the holy place, the table of showbread, the altar of incense, and the seven branch candlestick. But we're going to begin with the table of showbread. And I invite you to turn your Bibles to the book of Exodus chapter 25. And I know that many of you might just be listening in, but I hope you can get your Bible out and really just go through these scriptures with me and even take time to read them when a volunteer is called for. So we're going to Exodus chapter 25, and we're going to look in verses 23 through 29. And I'll go ahead and start this first reading here. So Exodus 25, verses 23 through 29. And here the Bible is going to describe the table of showbread. And there's something specific that I want you to see in these particular scriptures that we're reading. There is something that is around the rim or the border of the table that I really want to kind of pay some attention to at this time. So as I read these scriptures, I'll let your eyes fall upon the verses that describe this. So in Exodus 25, verse 23 through 29, the Bible says, "Thou shalt also make a table of shittim wood. 2 cubits shall be the length thereof, and a cubit the breadth thereof, and a cubit and a half the height thereof. And thou shalt overlay it with pure gold, and make thereto a crown of gold round about. And thou shalt make unto it a border of a handbreadth round about, and thou shalt make a golden crown to the border thereof round about. And thou shalt make for it 4 rings of gold, and put the rings in the 4 corners that are upon the 4 feet thereof. Over against the border shall the rings be for places for the staves to bear the table. And thou shalt make the staves of shittim wood and overlay them with gold, that the table may be borne with them. And thou shalt make the dishes thereof and the spoons thereof and the covers thereof and the bowls thereof to cover withal, for pure gold shall thou make them." Now, a few things can be brought out here, but if you look at that last verse, right, verse 29, and this is not the verse I specifically was asking to look for, but just notice here in verse 29, the Bible shows that the table of showbread, they had dishes, there were spoons, covers, bowls. This was a full table setup. This was not just if you have in your mind a table where they just sat bread on it. It was a full table that covered. It covered like a meal, all right? And that is very important to notice. It was a full meal setup that was described there with the table. And we'll come back to that. But what I do want you to notice, if you look in verse 24 and 25, the Bible describes that around the table, there was a crown of gold. There was a crown that was on the border of the table. Now, the golden crown rim is expressive of the words of Paul in Hebrews chapter 2, verse 9, where Paul is describing Jesus, and he says that he was made a little lower than the angels, but he for the suffering of death, but he was crowned with glory and honor, right? And so when we're looking at the crown, one of the things that we can see that a crown represents, and this table having this crown upon it, is a symbol of glory and honor. So as the man, as the human being, the person comes into the sanctuary, and of course I'm speaking not literally, even though you can say literally here, we would be represented by the priests entering into the sanctuary. But in the Christian walk is what I'm describing here, as we would enter into the work of sanctification or entering into the realms of sanctification, the first thing that we would be confronted with is this table of showbread, this table that provides a full meal for those who enter in. And the Bible describes that this table has a crown round about it, a symbol of glory and honor. But it also represents something else. Crowns can represent many different things. Royalty is one of them. But I want someone to read for us James chapter 1, verse 12. All right, James chapter 1. Verse 12. And keep in mind that as we're coming into the holy place, having our sins forgiven and having our iniquities washed away at the laver, now we're walking and growing in grace. There is something that the table of showbread specifically identifies for us in the Christian walk. So in James chapter 1, verse 12, what else does a crown symbolize?
Amen. It says, James 1, 9, let the brother of low degree...
112.
Oh, I'm sorry. Blessed is the man that endureth the temptation, for when he is tried, he shall receive the crown of life, which the Lord hath promised to them that love him.
All right, sister, thank you. So notice in verse 12, the Bible's talking about those who endure temptation. And it says that when he is tried, he will receive a crown of life. And of course, this trying that's being referred to here and the reception of the crown of life identifies that the individual never gave into temptation, but he was tried, he was tempted, but he overcame. So the crown of life is a symbol of the overcoming of sin. And it reminds us that when we come to the table of showbread, we can receive from Jesus victory over our sins. He is able to keep us from falling. And specifically at the table of showbread, there was something that we can partake of that will aid us in having victory over sin. We know that the table of showbread has bread upon it. And bread, of course, in the scriptures is a symbol of the word of God. And the Bible shows us very clear that the word of God is one of the aids that God uses or agents that he uses to give us victory over sin. Because we're told very clear by David in Psalms 119 that thy word have I hid in my heart that I might not sin against thee. So at the table of showbread, the bread, which is the word of God, aids us in having victory over sin. And that crown that is about the table is a symbol of the crown of life that is given to all those who will have victory and endure against temptation. All right, so we're coming on in our walk of sanctification. The very first agent God uses to aid us in growing in grace is the table of showbread, where we can have victory over sin, where we can have the glory and majesty of the crown of life given to those who endure temptation. And the bread on the table is the very thing that if we would hide it in our heart by putting it in our minds, right? The Bible shows us that we would have victory. We would not sin against him. Now, there was something else that we read in the book of Exodus. So in Exodus 25, we don't turn back there, but in Exodus 25, the Bible describes that there were four rings that were to be put on the four corners of the table that would be borne with the staves, right? Those staves or the wood that was covered in gold, they would slide those through those rings and they would be able to carry the table. So one of the things that we know of or learn from this is that the table of showbread was portable. It went wherever it needed to go, right? Wherever the people needed it, the table of showbread can be moved. So the question is, what lesson is here for us? What lesson do we learn about the table of showbread not being fixed, instead being movable? Let's look at a few verses together. Let's turn in our scriptures to the book of Psalms, chapter 16. We're going to Psalms 16, verse 8. And if I can get a reader for Psalms 16 and the 8th verse. Psalms 16, verse 8.
Psalm 16:8. I have set the Lord always before me, because he is at my right hand. I shall not be moved.
All right, thank you. So remember, we can have victory over sin at the table of showbread, the crown of life being given to those who have victory over sin, the bread being that which is used to aid us in overcoming sin and not sinning against the Lord. And so the fact that the table of showbread is movable, we can set the Lord always before us. We can take him with us wherever we go. All right, there's another scripture that bears this out in the book of Proverbs, chapter 6. In Proverbs, the 6th chapter, we're going to look at verses 20 through 22. Proverbs chapter 6, verse 20 through 22, and notice what it says here. It says, my son, keep thy father's commandments and forsake not the law of thy mother. Bind them continually upon thine heart and tie them about thy neck. When thou goest, it shall lead thee. When thou sleepest, it shall keep thee. And when thou awakest, it shall talk with thee. And so the Bible here is describing that wherever we go, that we're at home, we're in the office, vacation, we're sleeping, no matter where we are to have communion with our Savior. at the table of showbread. And that was something that's also beautiful about the table, an aspect that we can kind of flesh out maybe later on. But remember, the Bible promises us in the book of Revelation that if we would invite him in, remember, he says, "Behold, I stand at the door and knock," in Revelation chapter 3. He says, "If any man hear my voice," and he says, "I will come into him and will sup with him," and have, in other words, have supper with him, and he with me. In other words, God wants to have this intimate relationship with us where we can have share a meal, right? That's the description there in the book of Revelation chapter 3. And that's because in the Eastern culture, sharing a meal, sitting down for a meal, sitting down for supper is one of the most intimate experiences that one can have. And so here we can always have this communion with our Savior. The table of showbread can go with us wherever we need it, whether we're on the job, whether we're on vacation, whether we're at work, whether we're at school, it's always there, and we can have that connection, with Jesus. And it's very important that we understand that point, because many Christians make their connection with Jesus based upon when they go to church, or when they're at prayer meeting, or when they're having devotion, but they don't carry God with them at all times during the day or during their experience. But we can have this experience of constant fellowship and communion with Christ at the table of showbread. All right. Now I want to kind of shift focus a little bit and kind of go back to Exodus chapter, this time chapter 26. Exodus chapter 26. We were looking at Exodus 25 before, but I want to go to Exodus 26. Because there we learn something else about the table of showbread. And this actually has to deal with the location that the table of showbread was placed in the sanctuary. Everything about the sanctuary, from its articles, from its materials, from its colors, we're learning that it means something, as well as the placement of the furniture. The fact that it's placed in its various locations is very important. So where was the table placed in the tabernacle? All right, so we're in Exodus 26, and we're going to read or have read verse 35. So if I can have someone read for us, Exodus 26, verse 35.
"And thou shalt set the table without the veil, and the candlestick over against the table on the side of the tabernacle toward the south. Thou shalt put the table on the north side."
All right. And so the Bible's very clear that the table of showbread, was put over against the veil. In other words, it was on the outside of the veil, speaking of the inner veil that separated the holy from the most holy place. So it was in the holy place. And the Bible talked about how the candlestick was against it, meaning it was, kind of facing it. If you're the table and you're looking before you, the seven branch candlestick would be right before you, and that would be on the south side of the sanctuary. So therefore, the table itself is placed on the north side. It's placed northward, and the Bible is very clear on that in many different texts. So, why is that important? What is associated with the north? All right. Now there are prophetic things we can get into, and we're not looking at it from a prophetic standpoint, just some very wonderful thoughts for you to consider when you're having your communion with God. So the question is this: what is associated with the north in the Bible? Go to Psalms 48, Psalm chapter 48, and we're going to look in verses 1, 2, and 3. So Psalm 48, verse 1, 2, and 3. The Bible says this. It says, "Great is the Lord, and greatly to be praised in the city of our God, in the mountain of his holiness. Beautiful for situation, the joy of the whole earth is Mount Zion. On the sides of the north, the city of the great king. God is known in her palaces for a refuge." So here in the Bible tells us that what is associated with the north is Mount Zion, all right? Mount Zion, or elsewhere in the Bible, it's called the Mount of the Congregation, right? And we'll see this in the book of Isaiah chapter 14. So Mount Zion, or the Mount of the Congregation, is in the sides of the north. And Mount Zion, or the Mount of the Congregation, is a Hebrew word called Har, it's Har Moed, which literally means the place or mountain of assembly. And this is where God would meet with his people. So when it was in the wilderness wanderings, God would meet his people at the entrance of the tabernacle, which is, you know, closest to the table of showbread. He would meet them there, or he would meet them on the Temple Mount when the actual physical temple was built. That was his place of meeting with his people. But today, the mountain of the congregation on the sides of the north is a symbol of the congregation. It's a symbol of where God's people meet when they come together in church capacity. This is where we are to meet with God. We can also meet with him in our daily devotions. But what we're having here, the sides of the north, is the place of meeting where God would meet with his people. Now, the north is very important because as we're trying to meet with God, there is an accuser of the brethren, Satan, who also tries to assume power over our communications or our congregation with God. Notice what it says in the book of Isaiah 14. Isaiah chapter 14, still dealing with the north here, very well-known scripture, Isaiah 14 verses 12 through 14. So we're looking at Isaiah chapter 14, verse 12 through 14. If I can get a reader for that. Isaiah 14, 12 through 14.
How art thou fallen from heaven, O Lucifer, son of the morning? How art thou cut down to the ground, which didst shaken, weaken the nations? For thou hast said in thine heart, I will ascend into heaven. I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. I will sit also upon the mount of the congregation, in the sides of the north. I will ascend above the cloud, the heights of the clouds. I will be like the Most High.
All right, thank you. And so as you're reading Isaiah chapter 14, one of the things that you see here is that from the beginning of this controversy, Satan has always tried to occupy the very point where God was to meet with his people, the sides of the north, the mountain of the congregation. He always has tried to insert himself in that place. And he does so by numerous ways, by distracting us, by keeping us back from the study of the word of God and from prayer, because he knows that it's at the mount of the congregation, it's at the place of meeting on the sides of the north, where we get spiritual strength to be able to grow in favor with God. Now, I want to read a statement with you. This is, or a statement for you. This is found in Gospel Workers, page 100. Listen to what it says. It's very short, three sentences. It says, guard jealously your hours for prayer, Bible study, and self-examination. Set aside a portion for each day or of each day for a study of the scriptures and communion with God. Thus you will obtain spiritual strength and will grow in favor with God. And so Satan wants to distract us from this, because he doesn't want us to be able to grow in grace in the walk of sanctification. He doesn't want us to come to the fullness of the measure of the stature of Christ. He doesn't want us to come up to the standard. And so he inserts himself in that particular place of meeting on the sides of the north. But it's a beautiful thought when we consider, even though God wants to meet with us there and Satan is there trying to keep us from their communion with God, he's there on the sides of the north trying to usurp God's authority and God's power in our life. There is a promise that we're given in the book of Psalms 23. And in Psalms 23, it's very beautiful, Psalms 23 verses 4 and 5. And you know this psalm, this is the shepherd's psalm, right? The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. But look at verse 4 and 5 of Psalms 23. And when we consider the table of showbread in the sides of the north, and that's there where the enemy of God is trying to usurp God's authority, and it's there where we have communion with God, and it's there that the great controversy has started. Notice what Psalms 23 says in verse 4 and 5. The Bible says, yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me, thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparedest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, my cup runneth over. And it's such a beautiful thought here to consider that God has set a table for us, even in the very presence of our enemies on the sides of the north. And he is there to commune with us. It says he anoints my head with oil, my cup runneth over. When you do a greater study of the table of showbread, you'll see that on that table was not just the bread, which is why it's called the table of showbread, but we read also that it had the different utensils, the bowls and the different things and vessels. And that's because wine was also there and oil was also there. And so the language of Psalms 23 verse 5 takes us directly back to the table of showbread, the place where God has prepared a table for us, even in the presence of our enemies. And it teaches us that even though we are assaulted by Satan, even though we are tempted by the evil one, even though when we come to commune with God in prayer and our mind becomes distracted and different thoughts come in, God is a very present help in trouble. Remember the wonderful promise of Psalms 48, verses 1 through 3, where it talked about how beautiful for situation the joy of the whole earth is Mount Zion on the sides of the north. The Bible said in verse 3 that God is known in her palaces for a refuge, meaning there on the sides of the north, we can run to the Lord and find safety. So friends, jealously guard your hours for prayer and Bible study and self-examination. Don't let Satan usurp authority on the sides of the north, a place of communion with your soul and God. Instead, run to the Lord and find safety and refuge, because there he has prepared a table in the presence of your enemy. And before we close, I want to just look at two more basic thoughts. Go back to Exodus chapter 25. Exodus chapter 25. So we're going to Exodus 25, and I want you to look at verse 30. There's some language in the verse I want to remind you of. So go back to Exodus 25 and verse 30. And I'll read this verse, and then I want to have a volunteer read for us Leviticus 24, 5, and 6. So get ready if you're going to be that volunteer to read Leviticus 24, 5, and 6. But I'm going to read Exodus 25, verse 30. This describes what was indeed placed upon the table, right? So in verse 30, it says, "And thou shalt set upon the table showbread before me always." In other words, bread was supposed to be on the table all the time. At all times, bread was upon the table. There was never a time where bread was not on the table. If the priest was removing the bread as it became old or it was going to be eaten, it was always replaced. So there was always sustenance on the table of showbread. So keep that in your mind. But I want you to read for me Leviticus 24, verse 5 and 6.
Leviticus 24, verse 5 and 6. "And thou shalt take fine flour and bake 12 cakes thereof. 2/10 deals shall be in one cake, and thou shalt set them in two rows, 6 on a row upon the pure table before the Lord."
All right, so thank you for that. So notice here, when we're talking about the table of showbread, the Bible shows that bread was upon the table, but then it describes that it was going to be two rows of 6 pieces of bread, right? So in other words, you had this these two stacks of 6 loaves of bread, and this would be 12 in number. And so these 12 unleavened loaves, of course, would represent God's people, the 12 tribes of Israel at that time. But there's something that I want you to kind of have in your mind. If you're looking at the word showbread actually literally means the bread of faces, or bread of the presence is another way that the original language describes the showbread. So the bread of faces, or the bread of the presence. And this literally, it's symbolically giving us the idea that when we're at the table of showbread, here we are face to face with God, all right? This is where God meets with his people. And the lesson that we learn here, as we have the 12 loaves presenting themselves before the Lord, the first thing that we learn is that that we're in God's presence at his table. There is spiritual food sufficient to feed all of his children. It didn't have 10 loaves. There were 12 tribes, so it had 12 loaves of bread. So there's sufficient spiritual food to feed all of God's children. But then we also learn that believers are always in the presence of Christ, because the bread is a symbol of the 12 tribes of Israel. The bread also is a symbol of God himself. But from this angle, we're looking at the bread representing God's people. And so we are always in the presence of Christ, and he never fails to see us. The bread of faces, or the bread of the presence, he's always there. He can never forget us. You know, it kind of reminds me of the wonderful scripture in Isaiah chapter 49, where he tells us that we have been engraven upon the palms of his hands. And so the Lord can never forget us. We are always there before him. But there was another name for the showbread. And this is going to be our last thought. All right. So we're going to look at two more scriptures. Let's go to Numbers chapter 4, verse 7. Numbers chapter 4, verse 7. All right. Let us look at what another name that was given to the showbread. So in Numbers chapter 4, verse 7, and then also 2 Chronicles chapter 2, verse 4, and I will read both of these in closing. So in Numbers 4, 7, it says, "And upon the table of showbread, they shall spread a cloth of blue and put thereon the dishes and the spoons and the bowls and covers of to cover withal, and the continual bread shall be thereon." So notice on the table of showbread, they placed all these wonderful things, and you may have seen some different things there that can maybe have your mind running in your own study, where on the table of showbread, it was covered with a blue cloth, symbol of the law, right? But it shows here that the continual bread should be thereon. So it wasn't just called showbread, or the bread of the presence, or the bread of faces. It was called continual bread. And then in 2 Chronicles chapter 2, verse 4, it says this. It says, "Behold, I build an house to the name of the Lord my God, to dedicate it to him and to burn before him sweet incense, and for the continual showbread, and for the burnt offering morning and evening on the Sabbaths, and on the new moons, and on the solemn feasts of the Lord our God. This is the ordinance forever to Israel." So notice the Bible describes that the bread is the continual bread, the continual showbread. And it goes along with what we read in Exodus chapter 25, verse 30, where the Lord said it was to always be before him, right? So the table again was never empty. And friends, I want to encourage you with this final thought. The significance of that, the fact that the table is never empty, that there's always food upon the table, all right? The significance of that is that there is never a time when we would come to God for spiritual help that he would turn us away saying that he has nothing to provide. We can always go to him, right? He actually tells us, it's a wonderful promise in John chapter 6, verse 35, where he says, "He that cometh to me shall never hunger." And so friends, if we ever need anything from God, any spiritual food, anything to sustain our life spiritually, we can come to him, because there will never be a time where there is not bread on his table. So friends, go boldly before the Lord to find mercy and grace to help in your time of need. So with those things tonight, we're going to turn to the Lord in prayer, and we are going to break up into our prayer rooms together. And so I invite you to remain behind. And before we do so, let me just explain this here. There's been a trend not necessarily a trend, but I've noticed that when we go into the prayer room, sometimes people leave the Zoom meeting. Friends, this is prayer meeting. We didn't just come to hear a study or to just get some, you know, praise reports. We need to pray. This is the very reason why we're here. So with the thoughts that we have laid down tonight, God providing for us, always there before us, anytime we need him, never turning us away, let's go to him in prayer and praise his name and thank him for those things.